Good morning. Good day. We're just having a great day. We just talk about, we have the cameras here. We might ought to put a kiss cam in our church since we have so many people who are so good at it. But then someone said, what we need to really put in is a sleep cam. That might really get people's attention. So watch out. We're just always full of ideas. But good to see you today. It is a beautiful day and a good day to be in your church. And we had a wonderful service early. Good Sunday school, and we have something very, very special tonight. The Millsaps College Chamber Singers will be with us at 5 this evening, and this is a part of a traveling group out of the Millsaps Singers, which is tremendous, tremendous young voices. Beautiful service, good music, good people. I hope that you can be here tonight at 5 o'clock and support that. It's one of our great Methodist schools, and it'll be fun. So I hope that you can be here tonight at 5 to enjoy that in our sanctuary. The women are working on their Lenten breakfast. Comes up February 28th at 9 o'clock, and the information about tickets is there in your bulletin. We are just overwhelmed with the response to Disciples Path. We've had to order more books again. And we got some books out there that have people's names on them that they've ordered, but we still have another batch of books coming this week. So we hope to get everybody covered this week. But we appreciate you being part of that. We appreciate those who just took the books home, because we want you to be part of the whole program. The sermons, the classes, the individual readings, but it's a great book to take home and use for your daily devotions, and we certainly don't mind you doing that, because there's much you can learn, and I'm going to talk a little bit more about that later in the service. Busy time in the life of the church, a lot of announcements, so please take note later on of all the different other announcements that are going on in our church over the next few weeks. We're glad that you're here today. Hope that you'll sign the attendance pads. We might have a record of you being here. Appreciate you coming to share in this service today. Especially want to welcome our visitors who are here with us today. Now take your bulletin and stand as we turn to our call to worship. Truly my soul finds rest in God.
My salvation comes from Him.
Truly He is my rock and my salvation.
He is my fortress.
Most gracious God, we are glad that you are the rock, the solid rock upon which we base our lives. We are here today to worship. We are here today to praise you for all you've done for us. Bless this time. We are here in the name of Jesus the Christ. Amen.
The hymn of praise is number 110, A Mighty Fortress is Our God.
Thank you.
please remain standing as we share our faith together through the Apostles' Creed. May we unite this historic confession of our Christian faith. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended to heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Be seated.
Let's go to our Lord in a time of prayer. Most good and gracious Heavenly Father, we do thank you for this gift of prayer, this opportunity to express ourselves, to reach out to you, to lift up our voices. Hear our prayers. Hear our prayers because we bring them from our heart. We pray for each other. We pray for our church. We pray for our disciples' past study as we try to grow as disciples. We lift up those who are hurting. We have friends who have lost loved ones in the last few days. We have friends who are in the middle of the battle against cancer. We have friends who are getting over their surgery. We have friends who are preparing for their surgery. We have friends who need to know your forgiveness, your hope. They need to see a way out of whatever darkness they're in. We have friends who are just hurting and need your comfort. Help us to be part of that comfort. Help us to show our love and our support. But let we pray for your power to bind us all together as we move forward together into your life. We thank you for so many things. We thank you for this church. We thank you for the chance to worship, to sing, to pray. We thank you for your Son, Jesus Christ, who came to teach us and to show us his way. And we pray the prayer he taught us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Now time for our children.
Good morning. Good morning. Y'all okay? Gather on around. Good morning. Come on up. You can have a seat right here if you want to. I'm glad you're here. Tell me your name. What is it? Callie. I'm so glad to meet you. Glad you're here. Good morning. It's great to see you all. I saw some of you playing upward yesterday. Some good players and some of you playing other places in basketball. It's great to see you. I wanted to show you a newspaper. This is the Starkville Daily News. Now, when somebody writes an article for the newspaper, people at home, like every morning, we get our newspaper out of our box and we read it, and we want to read the facts about a story. So whoever wrote that article to tell us all about the story is going to tell us five things. There are five things we're looking for. They all start with a W. I want to see if you can help me name them. Who, what, when, where, why? Good. That's right. Who, what, when, where, and why? Those are all the things we want to know about the subject that we're going to be reading about. Well, this morning, our subject, the thing we're talking about in prayer, in church, is prayer. Brother Giles is going to preach about it. The choir, the ladies have sung about it. So prayer. So I wanted us to talk just a minute this morning about the five W's of prayer. And I want you to help me because I think you probably already know most of these things, if not all of them. First one I'm going to ask you, who can pray? Can just certain people pray? Do you have to be 30 years old to be able to pray? No. Anybody can pray. Anybody can pray. Doesn't matter how old you are or where you live or what you do. Anybody can pray. Who? The next one is when? No, what? I'm getting ahead of myself. What do we pray about? What do you think? What do you think about when you think? What do you pray about? Friends and family. Anybody else want to add anything? What's something you?
Our father and our mother.
Yes, family, our father, mother, Harlan. Things we need. Exactly. Right. We can pray about things we need. We can pray about our families. We can pray to say thank you to God. For when we're happy, we can pray. When we're worried, we can pray to ask God to help us when we're in trouble. We can ask God to take care of sick people who need him. So those are just a few of the things we can pray about. So when can we pray? Whenever. We can pray anytime, not just at 11 o'clock on Sunday morning, right? We can pray anytime. And if we're really talking to God about all the things we said we prayed about, what did we pray about? Then that would be pretty much any time. So pray any time, all the time we can pray. The next thing is where. Where do we pray?
Church.
Church is one place. Yeah, anywhere. In your house? At night? Where?
At the bank.
At the bank? That's exactly right, yes. That Helen, I do that a lot. You're exactly right. But you're right, and I love the way you said that, because whatever store we go into, whatever bank, doctor's offices, schools, car, soccer field, anywhere we can pray, anywhere, wherever we are. Now let me ask you this, why do we pray? We pray because we love God. And there's several things here. One thing is, if you have a really good friend, we talked about this in Faith Factory this morning. If you have a good friend, you spend time with that friend, don't you? And when you spend time with that friend, you get to know that friend better. So when we spend time talking to God and listening to God, because we have to remember, prayer just isn't about us talking. Prayer's listening, too. So when we spend time talking and listening to God, we get to know Him better, and we love Him more. We also pray because God answers prayer. Now, God's our Heavenly Father. Let me ask you something. Do your mom and daddy give you anything and everything you ask for?
No.
No. And why? Because they love you and they want what's best for you. Well, God's our Heavenly Father, and He's the same way. And even though it may seem sometimes that God doesn't answer our prayer, and it doesn't seem like He doesn't do it as fast as we want Him to, we can trust that God is our Heavenly Father, and He loves us, and He hears us, and He'll answer our prayer in whatever way He knows is best for us. So anybody can pray about anything, anytime, anywhere, because God loves us. He wants to hear from us, and when we talk to Him, we feel closer to Him. Let's pray right now. Would you pray with me right now? Thank you, God, so much that You love us. And thank You, God, that even though You are so big and powerful and made this whole world, that You still hear our prayers. God, help us listen to You when You talk back to us in prayer. Thank You for the way that we can feel close to You when we pray. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Hey, Helen.
This morning's offertory hymn is number 395. Let's stand and sing together, "Take Time to Be Holy."
Most gracious Heavenly Father, we thank you for the opportunity to share and give. We thank you for the opportunity to be part of your church. Bless these offerings today. We bring them in the name of the Christ. Amen. You may be seated. Thank you. thank Chip for that offertory and the ladies' ensemble for their piece earlier. And the choir has a beautiful piece ready for us in just a minute. I want to read from Psalm 62. Yes, my soul find rest in God. My hope comes from Him. Truly He is my rock and my salvation. He is my fortress. I will not be shaken. My salvation and my honor depend on God. He is my mighty rock, my refuge. Trust in Him at all times, you people. Pour out your hearts to Him, for God is our refuge. Surely the lowborn are but a breath, and the highborn are but a lie. If weighed on a balance, they are nothing. Together they are only a breath. Do not trust in extortion or put vain hope in stolen goods. Though your riches increase, do not set your heart on them. One thing God has spoken, two things I have heard. Power belongs to you, O God. And with you, Lord, is unfailing love. And you reward everyone according to what they have done. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Thank you.
Howard was our church atheist. Every church has one or three church atheists. Sam was a good guy, and Sam was our church optimist. And Howard was a fine man too, an honest, upright, moral person. He's sort of like the guy in the Christmas Eve story we tell about the guy, man who's trying to get the birds into the barn. A good man, he just doesn't believe. And he came to our church because his wife came to our church. He never made a big deal out of what he did or didn't believe, never got into arguments with anybody, but he was too honest to pretend something he wasn't. He came with her. He enjoyed the fellowship. He would be glad to lend a hand on a service project. If we were cleaning the church, he would be there. But when she joined the church, he didn't. He thought it'd be hypocritical to take some vows that he really did not believe. Howard came to me one day. Sam had asked Howard to pray for him. Sam was going through a rough patch in his business, and Sam and Howard are friends, and Sam had asked Howard to pray for him. I'm sure Sam knew how Howard felt, but the need was real, and I'm sure this was Sam's gentle way of engaging his friend. And Sam was one of those good, hopeful, down-to-earth, do-anything-for-you sort of people that you just have trouble saying no to him. So here was Howard in my office asking me how to pray to a God that he wasn't sure he even believed in. And so after we got through the story of how this came about and why he was there, I told Howard that prayer was just like any other form of communication. You take your thoughts, you take your ideas, and you express them in some way. If you want to pray for Sam, think about what you want for Sam. Think about what you want to ask for Sam, and just tell God what you want. God will hear it. Now, I'm not sure how much of that he believed, but he did it. He did it because Sam asked him to. And I'm not going to tell you there was some sort of instantaneous change in Howard, but there was a change. He started taking a different interest in things. He started asking questions, not getting into an argument sort of questions, but why do y'all do this? And what is this about sort of questions? I moved from that church not terribly long after that happened, so I can't tell you how the story ended up. But I saw enough to know that Howard's path was different. Different than what it would have been if Sam had not asked him for a simple favor. Pray for me. Prayer is about communicating with God. But prayer is so much more. And one of the most important things prayer is, it's connection. We're doing this in our Disciples Path study, and we're emphasizing the tools, the spiritual disciplines, another word related to disciple, the means of grace by which we discover God and God's ways, by which we follow Christ and experience His presence in our life each day, and through which we continue to grow as disciples. That's a phrase you've heard before in this church. As we grow as disciples to become the people, the followers that God knows we can be. We keep growing all throughout our lives. And one of the distinctive emphases of Methodism is that being saved is just the beginning. We continue to grow in love, in faith, in living out the example of Christ all through our lives. And the fancy word for that is sanctification. And in some circles, that word is used to describe that final state when you've finally gotten to exactly where you want to be and you're full of holiness and everything God wants. But for Methodists, the emphasis is on sanctification as a process, a way in which God is at work in our lives, all through our lives, and a way in which we work with God all through our lives. And it isn't that some other denominations don't believe that you grow in faith, but we Methodists have always put more emphasis on it. From the very beginning, John Wesley called it going on to perfection. Now that phrase really didn't catch on very well because people said, you know, we're never going to be perfect. We're never going to not make a mistake. That just was not a practical phrase. And Wesley would agree that we're never going to reach that point where we're might not be mistaken about something, that we might not make an error, that we might not do something wrong. But he used the term in a manner that we don't always use the word perfect anymore, meaning more complete than without blemish. Because John Wesley did believe that we could get to a place where we would be as complete as we can be in this life, as filled with love, as filled with faith, as filled with the grace of God as we can be. And he thought it was possible, although he would admit it doesn't happen very often, and it probably doesn't happen until very late in life. And if you think you're there, you probably aren't there yet. But he did believe that it was possible to reach a point of being as complete in faith and love as is possible for a human on this earth. We still use that phrase, going on to perfection, as we ordain ministers in the Methodist Church. Part of the ordination service at annual conferences, they bring all of us new preachers who are about to be ordained down, and they ask us a bunch of questions. But one of the questions they ask, are you going on to perfection? And at that point, our friends and family who know us all too well start snickering. And then we start snickering too. And at that point, the bishop usually says, well, if you're not going towards perfection, in which direction are you going? And that's the direction we all hope to be going, not just ordained ministers. And so part of this disciple's path that we are on is leading us to be complete, leading us to be perfect. We're studying about these spiritual disciplines that help us grow as disciples and move as close to being perfect as we are going to get in this world. And one of the most important tools is prayer. Prayer is many things. Most of our psalms are prayers. Jesus gave us what we call the Lord's Prayer as an example of how to pray. I can remember getting this big discussion. It was an argument, actually, in psalms class back in seminary a long time ago, 34 years ago. And on one side, they were saying, well, no, a prayer needs this. And a prayer needs that. And a prayer has to have these components to be a true and proper prayer. And I was on the other side, the side that says, nah, yeah, some prayers might be better than others. But that every thought expressed towards God, whether it was well phrased or not, whether it was well thought out or not, whether it was appropriate or not, everything we express towards God is a prayer. Every prayer matters, and prayer takes many forms. Which reminds me of a story. There was a big meeting on campus, and the preacher who was supposed to do the invocation did not show up. So Dr. Keenum called on Sid Salter, good Methodist as he is, and asked him if he would lead the Lord's Prayer. And Sid was a little taken aback, but being a good Methodist, he was prepared, so he got up. And as he got up, he heard a voice behind him whispering loudly. It was Dr. Ruby saying, I bet you a dollar you can't do it. But he gets up, he goes to the podium, and starts off. Now I lay me down to sleep. I pray. And when he finished, he walked back, and Dr. Ruby pulled out a dollar and said, I didn't think you could do it. I've been waiting a long time to tell that story. There are all sorts of prayers. A prayer can be a congregation praying the Lord's Prayer together. A prayer can be a child kneeling by their bed praying, now I lay me down to sleep. A prayer can be a plea uttered to God in the midst of a football game, although God doesn't ever seem to answer those. A prayer can be a cry of pain, a cry of anger. Some prayers are probably more appropriate than others. Some prayers God wisely chooses to ignore. But every time we reach out for God, in words or thoughts or deeds, every time we reach out to God formally or informally, that is a prayer. I take great comfort in the passage from Romans where it says, likewise, the Spirit helps us in our weakness, for we do not know how to pray as we ought. But that very Spirit intercedes with sighs too deep for words. And God who searches the heart knows what is the mind of the Spirit, because the Spirit intercedes for the saints according to the will of God. In other words, what that says is that God hears And God knows. And God understands. Even when all we can say is, oh, God hears us. It's a wonderful thing. But then it starts, some people think, well, if God already knows and God already understands, then why pray? And my standard answer is that your spouse knows that you love them, but you need to tell them now and again. It's true. It points to a deeper thing about prayer. But we have to say it. We want to say it. We need to say it. Because prayer is as much about the connection as it is about the message. We pray to connect with God. Yes, prayer is communication, but it's more than just sharing our ideas. It's more than just expressing our thoughts. Prayer is about believing that somebody is out there. Prayer is about knowing that there is someone who hears and who knows and who understands and who empathizes and who responds, although in his own way. Prayer is about expressing our faith that God is there. And prayer is about building that relationship. Building that connection. As one writer said, it's about beating down the path between us and God. Have you ever watched a TV show or a movie where someone is in a crisis and they feel a need to pray and they start off, oh God, I'm not a praying man, or God, I haven't prayed to you in a long time, but here is what I need. God hears those prayers. God answers those prayers, again, in his own way. But how much better is it not to have to call on God as a stranger? How much better is it not to have to pray as if you don't know what to do, but rather reach out to someone with whom you already have a relationship, with whom you've already been talking, communicating, praying all of your life, with whom you already have that connection. Someone told me after the first service, reminds me that prayer is not 911. Now you can use it in an emergency, but it shouldn't just be 911 for you. It should be something constant. It should be something always there, because that's how we build that connection. So it's there when we are praying 911. Prayer is part of how we build our connection to God. And prayer is how we connect with others. Yesterday, I saw on Facebook, and that's another means of connection, but saw on Facebook that a very old high school friend of mine was sick and in the hospital, and they're not exactly sure what's wrong with him. And as I prayed for him right then and there, just sitting at my computer, it brought back this flood of memories, his blue Pinto, our freshman college dorm room, stories of MYF and double dates in our high school French class. Prayer connects people together. People have come up to me and said, I felt you praying for me. I know the feeling of being sick and have a group of people come around you and pray for you. You can feel that connection. You can feel that energy in the room. I know it's like every Sunday morning I come in here and someone comes and prays for me and with me before every service. And I can be distracted, or I can have too many things on my mind. But it's something about their coming and that little time and their prayer that ties us together and brings me back to this moment and this place and this community and what needs to happen next. I know prayer connected Sam and Howard together in a brand new way. Praying with people, praying for people, connects us with God, but it also connects us with each other. It shares love, it shares faith, it shares hope, it connects. There's so much more that prayer does. I could preach 3 or 4 more sermons on prayer very easily. And those of y'all who are doing the readings for Disciples Path, there's more that you will learn there. But for today, I want you to remember this. Prayer connects. Prayer connects us with God. Prayer connects us with each other. It's interesting that two of the stories that Jesus tells about prayer are two of the strangest and funniest stories that he tells in all of the Bible and all the gospel lessons. Because in one place, he compares God to a friend who is asleep. And you go and knock on his door at night because you need some bread because you've had company coming. And he says, I'm asleep and I'm in bed and the kids are in bed and I can't get up and help you. But because you keep knocking and won't go away, he finally gets up and gives you what you want. And then later in Luke's gospel, he tells even a stranger story because he compares God to a crooked judge. And a little old lady comes to him and wants him to hear her case, and he doesn't want to hear it because there's nothing in it for him. But she comes and she comes back and she hounds him until finally he hears her just to get this off his back. Now these images are a little silly. But maybe Jesus is trying to say how silly it is for him to have to tell us this again. But the point he's trying to make is, in both stories, pray. And pray. And keep on praying. It's not that God is a sleepy friend or God is a corrupt judge, but he uses those examples to remind us, don't ever be afraid to pray. Don't ever give up on praying just because the answer seems slow. Don't ever wonder if it's the right time to pray. But mostly, don't ever give up. Pray and pray and keep on praying. Because that's how we connect with God. And that is how we connect with each other. And that is a very important part of how we grow as disciples. Let us pray. Most gracious Heavenly Father, we do thank you for this gift. Help us to not take it for granted. Help us to use it to build that connection, to beat that path, to know your presence in our lives. Bless us. As we pray, for we pray in the name of Jesus the Christ. Amen. As always, we come to the closing hymn of this service and we open the doors of our church to any who would be a part of this church family.
Our hymn is number 117. Oh God, our help in ages past. Let's stand and sing together.
Thank you.
you will come back tonight and hear the Millsaps Chamber Singers. They will be very good. It'll be a wonderful, wonderful experience. But thank you for being here. And now may you go in peace, knowing that the love of God your Father, grace through His Son, Jesus Christ our Lord, and the power and the comfort of the Holy Spirit go with you. Amen.